Praise the Lord, church. Why don't we stand all across this house? Let's lift our hands and open with praise and worship. We worship you tonight, Jesus. We give you honor, Lord. We've come to give you our best praise tonight. We thank you for this day, God. Thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to come before you with thanksgiving, Jesus. Thank you for breath in our lungs today, God. Thank you for your many blessings throughout this day, Jesus. You are worthy of our worship, God. You are worthy of our praise and our adoration, Lord. It all belongs to you, God, throughout this service, Jesus. Help us to be in a position of praise and worship and pray to you, oh God. Lord, we've come to commune with you tonight, Jesus. We've come to spend time in your presence, seeking after your beautiful face, Lord. We need you in this house, God. Would you come and inhabit the praises of your people, Lord? Would you be pleased with our sacrifice of praise tonight? Would it go up before you as a sweet-smelling savor, oh God? Let it be pleasing in your sight, Jesus. Let it be pleasing in your sight, Lord. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! All hail, King Jesus! Have your way tonight, Lord. Thank you.
Praise God. Feel the Holy Ghost moving to this place. Amen. It's interesting that we're singing that song because this morning, about 6 o'clock, we started a Bible study. And honestly, if I'm honest, I wasn't really feeling much moving of the Spirit. But we got a little ways into that Bible study this morning, and Brother Peter said, I feel the Holy Ghost right now. Amen. And sometimes at 6 a.m. on Zoom, you're not feeling real spiritual, but all of a sudden the Holy Ghost will show up. Amen. And our Bible study broke out into a little bit of a prayer meeting. Amen. You never know when the Holy Ghost will show up in your situation. Amen. So if you're dealing with something or you're struggling with something, just keep being faithful. He's going to show up and he's going to begin to move in your situation. Amen. How many are thankful for the power of the Holy Ghost at work in our lives? Amen. Praise God. Let's read our scripture together. Enlarge the place of thy tent and let them stretch forth the curtains of thine habitations. Spare not, lengthen thy cords and strengthen thy stakes. For thou shalt break forth on the right hand and on the left, and thy seed shall inherit the Gentiles and make the desolate cities to be inhabited. Let's bring it cheerfully this evening.
So come now, Lord, like a mighty rushing wind. We want you, release the sound from heaven. So come now, Lord, like a mighty rushing wind. We want you, say,
come on, put your hands together tonight.
Prison shaking, chains breaking. hear it.
Can you hear the sound? Can you hear? Can you hear it? Can you hear the sound?
It's revival.
Heaven's coming down. Is anybody thankful that there's power in the name of Jesus? Chains break when we call him.
It's revival. Heaven's coming down.
Let me hear you shout with a voice of triumph.
God, praise God. Why don't you turn to somebody you're sitting by and tell them it's revival time. Hallelujah. Praise God. Somebody ought to clap your hands to the Lord. So happy to see each and every one of you here tonight. Now, I need to do a little setting in order here. Every now and then I have to do this because it's so exciting to come to Church of Pueblo. But we do have a standing rule that if your kid is not 5 years old, mom and dad need to run with them. Now, there's reasons for that. Some of you need the exercise. But we don't want the children getting hurt, and we don't want them just wandering off. We're teaching them how to worship, not just how to run. Praise God. And that begins with us. And we want them to run, but mom and dad, why don't you run with them? And let's keep order in this place. Praise God. Is that all right? Let's give the Lord a high praise. Can we do that? Hallelujah. It's revival. Praise God. Praise God. I am so thrilled and so excited to see each and every one of you here tonight. We know that God is moving in this place in a marvelous way. You know, I may add to that because some of the moms and dads are busy and there are people that are overseeing their children while they're ministering in the church. So if you are overseeing that kid and he wants to run and you're not mom and dad, run with him. Amen? We don't want to stop him. We just want to train him. Praise God. Psalms chapter 25 is where I want to go tonight. And I am just so thrilled and so excited about what Jesus is doing around here. Psalms chapter 25. Is Sister Juana home? Let's remember that family in prayer. Let's remember Brother Jeffrey and Sister Caitlin, it's not an easy thing to lose a parent. And you find out real quick in this life that really the only real definition of normal is the button on your dryer, because life is constantly changing. Have you noticed that? And we are creatures of habit, and we like a routine, and sometimes we get lulled to sleep by a false sense of security. But we all need the Lord desperately. How many of you thank God that we have Jesus in a time of need? Come on now, let's lift our voices. It's okay. Aren't you grateful to God that you have the Lord in a time of need? And I don't want to forget them. I also don't want to forget Sister Bernice, who is in this battle for her health. And Brother and Sister Lewis, we got your back. In the name of Jesus, amen. Praise God. Our God is a healer. He is a restorer. And so we want to remember that in our prayer. It's okay to have a prayer list. It's okay to have a prayer list. A few years ago, and I would still do this, I just don't know how to put a password on. I kept a prayer log in one of my computers. It was an older computer. I knew how to set the password on it. It wasn't an Apple. I don't know anything about Apples. And through the year, I would log my prayers every night. At the end of that year, I went back and I was absolutely astounded at all of the prayers that God had answered that I had wrote in that prayer log. It's okay to make a list and say, okay, God, I'm coming to you every day about this. Every day I'm coming to you. I'm going to bring this faithfully before you. Praise God. Praise God. That's right. Hallelujah. Psalms chapter 25, verse 4, David writes, and I quote, "Show me thy ways, O Lord, teach me thy paths. Lead me in thy truth and teach me. For thou art the God of my salvation. On thee do I wait all the day." And then in Psalms 51 and 13, this is David's prayer of repentance that he prays to God. I'm going to just read one verse. "Then will I teach transgressors thy ways." Everybody say thy ways. Or in today's vernacular, his ways. "And sinners shall be converted unto thee." Now I want you to go to Jeremiah chapter 7. Jeremiah chapter 7 and verse number 5 is where I'll begin reading. In Jeremiah the 7th chapter. Jeremiah writes, "For if you thoroughly," that means thorough, completely, everything that you can think of, "if you thoroughly amend your ways and your doings." This is a big scripture in the world that we live in today. "And if you thoroughly execute judgment between a man and his neighbor, if you oppress not the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow, and shed not innocent blood in this place, neither walk after other gods to your hurt. Then will I cause you to dwell in this place, in the land that I gave your fathers forever and ever. And I want to talk about the ways of God versus the ways of man. But before I do that, why don't you put your Bibles down? Some of you already have. Switch over from reading the text that we gave you. Raise your hands and lift your voices and let's ask God to speak to our hearts tonight. Can we do that? God, we love you and we thank you for your word. We ask that you would teach us your ways tonight. Let the inspiration of your word and your spirit be of such degree and such experience in our life that it not only shows us your ways, but it motivates us to walk in your ways and to do according to your word and your statutes. Oh God, we believe you for it. We praise you for it. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God, we don't only want to amend our ways, but we want to amend our doings as well in the name of Jesus. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. You may be seated. I have discovered through the years, my 35 years of living on this earth plus a few more years, that normally you will behave and you will do as you think. Now, sometimes that's not true. Sometimes people divorce their deeds from their beliefs, but really they do not divorce their deeds from their beliefs. They portray that they believe one thing, but you will really act, you will behave, you will do according to the real motivations that proceed out of our soul and our spirit. Inspiration. That's why it's important how we talk. We can motivate ourselves, or we can destroy. We can defeat ourselves before we ever get started. We can motivate our spouses, or we can destroy their confidence. And we're so geared to just actually living the way that we feel in this world that a lot of times we exacerbate the wrong kind of feelings in our life because we act upon the wrong feelings instead of changing the feelings by changing our thought process and accommodating the ways of God in our life. So in these two reading, both of these are part of my text tonight. And when you're building a sermon, they teach you to read the text, but it's important that you read the text and that you preach within the context of the sermon, within the text. You can't read the text and then make it say whatever you want it to say. And there are many people that are doing that with the Word of God today. When God is trying to tell us one thing, they're changing it to say whatever they feel like they want it to say. This is a very destructive habit that God wants to change in our life. And so when we begin to learn of God, it's a lot of times we get a caricature. We don't really know the real character of God, but because of what we hear other people say, or what we hear or what we may read about the Word of God, it helps us to develop a caricature or an image in our life. We were having Thanksgiving and we were talking about the books that really affected us, our family, as a family of readers. Mitch, do you read? Of course he reads. I'm giving him a hard time. Now, when him and Jeff were growing up, it was like pulling teeth to get them to read. They just would rather play the, what's that little, GameCube their whole life. In fact, Mom only let them play on weekends. She wouldn't let them play during the week. People say, well, that's just terrible. I know. They all turned out so terrible. Pray for us. But we were talking, we're readers and during Thanksgiving we were talking about the books that really affected us, that were great books in our life. Somebody brought up Ben-Hur. Was that you, Melody? And most of you probably didn't read it. You probably saw the movie. But I grew up in church. We didn't have TVs and we didn't go to the movies. I got another chapter to that. I still don't have a TV and I still don't go to the movies. Praise God. I don't want Hollywood poisoning my mind. But anyway, be that as it may, Grandma piped up and said, well, I got the video. And I jumped up and I said, no, don't watch the video. It'll mess up your imagination. Boy, it's quiet in here. And because there's something powerful about your mind that it builds images in your mind, and it, all right, everybody go ahead and laugh. Dear God, what we need is more babies around here. You think y'all are a bunch of Catholic the way you have babies and you don't believe in birth control. That's all right. We're having revival around here. But because we hear so much about God, we don't take the time to get to know God. And so our image of God is not a true image. It is a caricature. It is an icon. It is what other people said. Jesus dealt with this, and this is often a frustration of a teacher, a Bible teacher, a pastor, because you go through what Jesus goes through in Matthew chapter 16, where this is the ultimate test of Jesus' earthly ministry. In Matthew chapter 16, when he looks at his disciples and he says, whom do men say that I am? And so they begin to parrot, P-A-R-R-O-T, parrot what they have heard other people say about Jesus. Some say that thou art John the Baptist. And some say that thou art Elijah, and one of the other prophets. And the bantering breaks out, and there's a whole cacophony of voices and chattering, and as they talk about all of the ways that have become caricature and the image that they have of Jesus Christ. And Jesus stops the cacophony of voices and he says, but who do you say that I am? And Peter has been with him long enough now. And the spirit of revelation comes upon Peter. and he says, I got it. I know who you are. Thou art the Son of the living God. You're the Son of God. And Jesus said, Peter, flesh and blood hath not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. And then he makes a very powerful statement. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter. His very name means the rock. But Jesus is not talking about Peter as being the rock that the church is built on. But he's talking about the foundation of revelation. That you cannot, if you're going to have an effective life living for Jesus, you cannot continue to live with just a caricature of hearsay and a caricature that you read in some commentary somewhere or some icon and some image that you have built in your mind regarding who Jesus is and what his kingdom is. But if you're going to have a lasting relationship with Jesus Christ, and if you're going to have a victorious walk with the Lord Jesus Christ, you are going to have a revelation of who he is somewhere. You're going to encounter him. And it's going to be more than just a scripture and a Bible study, which is important. I can't overemphasize the importance of reading the Word of God. But somewhere, the reading of the Word of God is to bring you into the presence of God. The worship of God is to bring you in to the presence of God. And in his presence, he reveals himself to you. That's why in the book of Isaiah, I believe it is, chapter 6, Isaiah said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Isaiah was raised in the ministry. Isaiah was raised in royalty. He was around the finest preachers that Israel and Judah had to offer. But it wasn't until that year that his uncle died, who was the king, that somewhere or another he got a hold of God. And he said, I saw the Lord, and he was high, and he was lifted up, and the train filled, his train filled the temple, and he was ushered in to the holy presence of God. I don't know about you tonight, but I would like to be ushered in to the holy presence of God. I would really want to have a fresh revelation and understanding of God. And so it is that we become almost delusional about who God is. And in some cases that has happened. If I were preaching on the Godhead tonight, there are people that have never had a revelation of God, so it's just easy to tell them that, you know, it's got so bad now, there's people running around this city that saying God's a woman. Brothers and sisters, God is spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. But he did reveal himself. And that was in a man named Jesus Christ, who was God manifested in the flesh. Don't bring me all of this ignorance. That's not new stuff. But you can become so delusional by just assuming and receiving what other people say. And as apostolics, we get in our tower of hubris, and we think, yes, we know who Jesus is. But do we really know who Jesus is? Yeah, we know he's God, but have you encountered him? Has he revealed himself to you? Do you have experiences? How many times do I have to preach that our first encounter with God is affectual? Affection. You feel him. Well, I'm just not the touchy-feely kind. You are when you get a revelation of who God is. In fact, I think we ought to just raise our hands and tell him how much we love him, because it's an intimate relationship with him. Can you just give him worship and devotion right now? Oh, that's it. I love you, Jesus. I praise you. I honor your holy name, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Have you ever had a mentor in your life that affected you to such a degree that you wanted to be like them? Even to the degree when I was younger, I tried to walk like them and tried to talk like them and tried to preach like them. And that's not uncommon. People that influence your life to such a degree that you begin to emulate them. Well, that's a good thing as long as you do it right, that you don't misrepresent who they are. And so we talk about being like Jesus Christ. And in these two scriptures that I have given us tonight, they're actually, we have these scriptures, but they are juxtaposed to each other. They're not, they don't run parallel. These two texts that I read to us tonight are juxtaposed to each other. It is obvious by their context that they're not running parallel. One scripture talks about something totally different than the other scripture. One scripture talks about the ways of God, and the other scripture that I read to you talks about the ways of man, or our ways. Can you say amen? The Bible is very clear that our ways are not the ways of God, and God's ways are not our ways. Now, if you have never traveled extensively, it may be hard to relate to the example that I want to give tonight, but when you go to other countries, in fact, if you're doing short-term or even long-term missions, one of the things that they try to educate you on is the difference culturally, because they don't do things your way. And we have differences here in America that are like that too. One of the things that when I go to Asia, it drives me up a wall. Because when you go in their house, you have to take your shoes off. I grew up around a military man. A military man, you were always alert. You were always vigilant. My dad told me when you're driving, you never take your shoes off when you're driving. What if you're in an accident and there's an emergency? And you're trying to run around and help somebody barefooted. And that was driven in me. You just, when you are on duty, you don't take your shoes off. And the first thing you do when you go in their house, you bow and you take your shoes off. Man, y'all are quiet tonight. And because that is their ways are different than our ways. When you go to China, they eat bugs. Brothers and sisters, I do not like green eggs and bugs. I don't like bugs. I don't want nothing to do with bugs. I have no desire to eat bugs. Now, if I was starving to death, I would. But you can go to places in China and they put bugs on a stick and you spend money for bugs. I am not spending money for bugs. Oh, they're good for you. I don't care what they are. I'm not eating bugs. That's worse than onions, and onions are pretty bad. Uh-oh, I started a doctrinal dispute here tonight. See the different ways? And I could talk about other things. And I'm telling you that when people come into this church, they are not used to our ways. And their first impression, listen, Christian Growth Center, their first impression when they come in here is that those are our ways. But they are not our ways. That's what the devil wants them to think, that they are our ways. They're not our ways. Because before we came to church, we lived like they did. We had the same ways that they had. We had the same thoughts that they had. We had the same behaviors. We went to the same places. We did the same things that they did. And so when we came in here, it was just as new to us and just as revealing to us as it is to them. Now here's the deal, brothers and sisters. I'm getting ahead of myself. Who's influencing you? Are they influencing you to go back to the ways of the world? Are we influencing them to come on over, come on over, come on over? Don't get discouraged. I know. You're in a new kingdom here, and sometimes it takes a while. But I'll tell you, I'm going to tell you how they get it. That's why we have to have Holy Ghost Church. I'm way ahead of myself. I may get there, I may not. So I'm going to tell you right now, the way they get there is we all get in the Holy Ghost, because that's the way that we got there. We get in the Holy Ghost and the worship, what does the worship do? It reveals to them their God. They have encounters with God. The Bible is very clear that our ways are not the ways of God, and God's ways are not our ways. Isaiah 55:8-9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now, there have been people that have created agnostic systems of belief that want to tell you, see there, we can never encounter the ways of God. We can never encounter the thoughts of God. That's a lie. One of the ways that the thoughts of God is revealed to us is through His Word. I'm reading to you His ways right now. That's why the devil doesn't want you reading your Bible. The devil wants you reading everything else, or the devil wants you just taking everybody else's word for it. But I'm telling you, get in the Word of God. You say, well, I don't know how to read. Well, that used to be a good excuse, but it's not a good excuse anymore. You can download a Bible app, and it'll read for you. There are no excuses not to understand the Word of God anymore. Every day you ought to spend time in the Word of God. You may not understand it. It may be complicated for a while, but I'll tell you this, if you get in the Holy Ghost and you continue to stay in the Word of God, you will see His ways. Can you clap your hands and praise Him? Psalms 103 is one of my favorite books in the Bible. Psalms 103 and 1 starts out with, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Some of you have blessed Him, but not all that is within you has blessed Him tonight. But maybe before we leave here, all that is within us will bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Don't be ungrateful. Don't be unthankful. Just because you're going through a hard time doesn't mean that God hasn't been good to you. You'll come through that hard time, and you need to remember that He was good to you in the good times, and He was good to you in the bad times. Just stay in the fight. Just stay faithful. Forget not all His benefits. Who forgiveth thine iniquities? Who healeth all thy diseases? That's His word. Who redeemeth my life from destruction? Who crowneth me with loving kindness and tender mercies? Who satisfieth my mouth with good things so that my youth is renewed like the eagles? Did I quote it right? The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. And here we go. Here we go. Here we go. And He made known His ways unto the children of Israel. He made known His ways to His children. How did He make known His ways to His children? Made known His ways to Moses and His acts. acts unto his children. Moses saw the ways of God. And so because Moses was able to communicate the ways of God to God's people, they saw the action of God in their life. If you want to see, so I don't see his action. Well, you got to learn his ways. Even to the most simple thing that the Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my law, in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. That's his ways, brothers and sisters. The Lord is not paying attention to you if you want to just keep on sinning. Now, he's ready. He's willing and ready at the drop of a hat to redeem your life from destruction. But as long as you insist on going in your ways, I'm going to tell you something. God's a gentleman. He don't force his ways on anybody. He's not going to make you live for him. He's not going to make you somewhere you're going to fall in love with him and his ways, not just falling in love with him. I will tell you this. No, I won't tell you that. I don't have time to tell you that. I don't want to go down that road. I want to stay on track here. But the ways of God are so different than our ways that if you don't know him, it's hard to trust him and to follow after him. Now, some people think that this passage of God's word shows us that God is a God of Gnosticism. I've already explained that. Deuteronomy 8 and 8 says, therefore, thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God to walk in his ways. Now, how am I going to know his ways if I don't know his commandments? Some of the simplest commandments. What are the simplest commandments? What's the first commandment? Well, thank you for those one or two that are awake tonight. What's the first commandment? Hear, O Israel. The Lord our God is three distinct and separate persons. No, that's a lie. The Lord our God is one. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God, not those gods, thy God, with all of your heart. It's simple. If you want to know his ways, then you got to fall in love with him. Why is this the first commandment? Because humanity has a propensity to worship idols and to fall in love with idols. Why does humanity have a propensity to fall in love with idols and to worship idols? Because idols are created out of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Idols are really manifestations of self fulfillment of appetites and desires of humanity. Idols are just another way of getting our way. Idols are just another way of getting our way instead of conforming to the ways of God. Can you clap your hands to him? The word ways in this scripture in Deuteronomy is the Hebrew word derek, which means a road, or a course of life, a mode or of action, or a journey. It's where we get the word derelict, somebody that can't find the road. They're just wandering all over the place. They're derelict. They can't stay on course. I don't want to be a Christian derelict. I don't want to be a Christian hobo. I don't want to be a Christian homeless person. I'm not talking, maybe you don't have the money and you're homeless tonight. God will fix that if you start doing his ways, being faithful to God, paying your tithe, praying, living right. That's how you get out of that mess. But when I speak of derelict, that means people, they just can't stay on course. They don't understand the value of the paths of life, the path of holiness. It's not valuable to them. So this scripture, in this scripture, we can see that we can walk in the ways of God and have the same thoughts that God has. In contrast to this truth is the another truth, that we don't have to walk in the ways of God. We don't have to walk in the ways of God. It's a scary time for teenagers when they grow up and realize, well, I don't have to do what mom and dad said I got to do. I can sleep all day if I want to. I can curse and chew and spit and cuss and smoke and do whatever I want to do. Well, hopefully by that time they realize that there's a reason why mom and dad have set out a path and a course and a way, and they've tried to keep you from the destructive way. Hopefully by then you're talking the right language. You're talking a language of faith. You're talking a language of victory, not a language of defeat. Hopefully by then you're not content with putting other people down, but you realize that when I build other people up, when the tide rises, all the ships rise. I don't know about you, but I'm interested in everybody getting off of the ground. I'm interested. I think around here, if we talk like that as a church, we pray like that as a church, we worship like that as a church, my boat's not the only one that rises. As God begins to bless, the whole church is blessed. And then we spread that into this city, and we change the course of this city, and we change the ways of people in this city. Praise God. But we don't have to walk in the ways of God. There are three other ways that we can walk according to the scripture. Luke chapter 4, we have the temptation of the devil, or the temptation of Jesus when the devil comes to him. And the devil offers Jesus his way. The devil says, if you will do it my way, these are the rewards that I will give you. And it's a deal, because as Satan is a master of offering to us things that appeal to our flesh. Now, how many of you realize that our flesh is fallen? How many of you realize that your flesh don't get the Holy Ghost? One day, this flesh is going to be changed. Paul said, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we all shall be changed. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, for the trump of God shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we that are alive, we all shall be changed. And then he talks about this mortal body, this fallen body, shall put on immortality. It will change. But right now, it's still a mortal body. It doesn't have the eternality that your spirit has. It does not have the eternality that your soul has. Your soul can be changed by the Holy Ghost. Now, the actions of your flesh should be changed by the Holy Ghost, but that motivation comes because you have brought your flesh into submission to the will and the way of God. And that's a battle till Jesus comes. I don't want to get stuck there tonight, but that's a battle till Jesus comes. But Satan will offer you an easier way. He will tell you, you don't have to do it like this. Here, just jump. I'm telling you, it's just so easy to just jump off of this pinnacle. Jump off here. And he's already said in Psalms chapter 91, he quotes the Bible to him. Did you know that Satan can quote scripture as good as you can? Probably better than some of you. And he said, he quotes Psalms 91. He shall give his angels charge over you to bear thee up, lest thou dash thy foot. And he quotes Psalms 91 to Jesus. And Jesus looks at him like, you are the biggest idiot I ever laid eyes on. I'm the one that wrote Psalms 91. I'm the one that said Psalms 91. And so what Jesus looks back at him and says, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Don't put yourself in a position that all of a sudden you are putting God to the test in your life all the time. There are some things you don't put God to the test. You flee. You get out of there. You don't give the devil any occasion. The Bible says give no place to the devil. Can you clap your hands to him right now? And then there are the ways of the world. Jeremiah 2:18 says, and now what hast thou to do with the ways of Egypt, to drink the waters of Sihor? Or what hast thou to do with the ways of Assyria, to drink the waters of the river? We know that Egypt is a type of the world, and Syria is a type of bondage. And we talked a little bit about this in the Bible study this morning. Satan is a slave master. When you begin to serve him, when you give in to your flesh, when your flesh is a fallen nature of this world, then you will become a slave. If I'm going to be a slave, I'm going to be a slave to Jesus Christ. Because the Bible says, he whom the Son has set free is free indeed. And he of his own volition has offered us freedom. Even though I'm a love slave, I'm in love with him. I'm in love with Jesus so much I just can't get away from him. I have an addiction. I openly confess. My addiction is Jesus Christ. I just cannot live without Jesus Christ. I can't live without his word. I can't live without his people. I am just, he has done something to me that nothing else, nobody else could do. And so there's the ways of the world. I wish I had time to deal with all of these in detail tonight. And in some extreme cases, the worst of them all. This is the worst way of them all. And in extreme cases, I see people that get like this. We can walk in our own way. Hear me. That is the worst of all of them. When I pray, I say, God, whatever you do, don't turn me over to myself. Wrestle with me. Confront me. Don't let me have my own way, God. When I was a young man, my mama used to play it so pretty on the organ, and my mom and dad would sing that old song, Have Thine Own Way, Lord. Have Thine Own Way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. How many of you want God's ways and not your ways? Hallelujah. Proverbs 21 and 8 says that the way of a man is froward and it's strange. But as for the pure, his work is right. The word froward in this verse is the Hebrew word hafepak, which means very perverted. So the Bible tells us that the way of man is very perverted. If you get your way, your degradation will take you deeper and deeper and deeper. That's why I don't have time to talk about this. But when you get involved of addictions of morality, and you get involved in addictions of sex, and you get involved in addictions to money and addictions to unnatural relationships, you can't be satisfied. They become more and more strange. They become more and more perverted. It just does not stir the mind, and it doesn't create the excitement and the passion that it did when you first got involved in it. Hallelujah. But I don't want to be involved in any of those. Can you say praise the Lord? Now, I want to talk about this. I'm not going to get through all of this tonight. Brother Richard, come. But I want to talk a little bit about walking in the ways of man for a few seconds. It has been a puzzle to me why in some cases you see falling away of young people in a church, no matter how much you preach to them to seek the will of God, and no matter how much they seek the will of God. And I feel like that God has given me revelation in this area about his will and about his ways. The will of God is extremely important in our lives. However, his will not be carried out by people who do not know him. And so I see preachers just pounding young people. You got to get the will of God. You got to get the will of God in your life. You got to get the will of God. And there's no spiritual formation in their life. So instead of coming up here and just seeking to know God, they're coming, oh God, I want to know your will. No, you will. Give me Bill. Well, no, you will, God. Give me Jill. And there's a conflict of desires because they're looking for the will of God instead of knowing the ways of God. If they know the ways of God, they'll trust him that he will bring into their life whoever that he has chosen to bring in their life. Job knew God so well that he said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. So, our effort around here is we center on formation. I see Okay, now's when I really need to start pastoring, and y'all ready for me to quit. But I really need to start pastoring now that I've got this foundation laid, because I see service leaders in this church, and they'll get up here, and one of the things that, and I do it, I'm guilty of this too, but you hear them, they get up behind this pulpit, and they're saying, come on, come on, come on, come on. They sound like cheerleaders. Well, that's the way we've been taught to lead service. But I wonder what would happen if they got up here and they forgot who was standing in front of them. And they said, okay, God, it's been a while since you and me had an encounter. And God, I love this song. Because in this song, I can worship you. I'm not just looking for a song to get everybody excited here tonight. I'm looking for a song that will usher them into the presence of God, where people that have been working hard all day and they're tired in their body, and some of them are discouraged, and they're fighting financial battles, and they're fighting demons that are trying to destroy their faith. But they walk in the house of God, and there's a service leader that's just as interested as they are. And as the church begins to sing together, the refreshing revelation of God comes in there, and you don't have to tell them, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. They may not be running the aisles, but you look out there and you'll see tears flowing down. What's happening? They're in the presence of God. They're catching that wave. They're learning the ways of God. And when you learn the ways of God, all of a sudden, I can't explain it. It's just like a button. You begin to fulfill the will of God in your life. Because the will of God is not just one situation, but the will of God is a lifetime that you live. And it's experiences that you go through. And it's trials where you face fierce resistance from the devil as you fight your way through to a new dimension, and you kick rulers off of paradigms that God wants you to have in your life. And I watch this as some people get it, and as they get it, they grow, and their life becomes so fulfilled, their life becomes so full of God. I watch young people as they learn to get it. If I can ever get one thing, if I could ever challenge you young men, and this will be one of the hardest disciplines you ever learn, it's to learn how to pray on your own. Not somebody asking you to pray, but every day you get up and you find a place and you say, before this day begins, God, you and me are going to have an encounter. You and I, we're going to talk. You have encounters. Sister Gina used to sing the song in this church. I didn't come here to ask you for anything. I just came to talk with you, Lord. Maybe tomorrow there'll be something, heartaches and sorrow, and 1,000 teardrops may fall. But until I face tomorrow's task, I have no special favor to ask. I just want to know you, God. I just want you to reveal yourself. Now here in a few minutes, God, you may give me a task. In a few minutes, I may get a phone call and I'm off to the hospital and I'm off to minister and I'm off to encourage somebody. But right now, God, that's not my task. Right now, God, I just want to know your ways. When I open the Bible, would you talk to me, God? Would you reveal yourself to me? Children of Israel saw the action of God because Moses saw the way of God. And I have to say this before I close. Some of the ways of God are obvious in the scriptures. They're surface. We know that the way of God, the way of salvation, is to repent and to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin. That is a very obvious way of God. That is a commandment of God. That's the way, that's the only way to enter into the kingdom of God. Jesus said, except a man be born of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Jesus said that. I didn't say that. Now, we've got people today that are trying to make you easier ways for you to get in the kingdom of God. But Jesus already told you, if they enter in any other way, they're a thief and a robber. So we know that's an obvious way of God. But then there are the ways that are the undercurrents of God. They're there. You just can't see them on the surface. Joshua 4:24 says that all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty, that you might fear the Lord your God forever. Let's look at some of these undercurrent ways of God. Psalms 85:12-13. Yea, the Lord shall give that which is good, and our land shall yield her increase. Righteousness shall go before him and shall set us in the way. Righteousness will set us in the way. Brother Richard, there's nothing more frustrating to a musician than to know how to play a song and play with other people, and they're not playing it the right way. And you're sitting there and you're gritting your teeth and you're saying, Lord, help me keep the Holy Ghost. Lord, help me keep the Holy Ghost. But you want to stand up and say, why don't you get it right? And when I was younger, I used to do that. Thank God the Lord has helped me pray through. But I would come out of the office in the old church and I would say, somebody is flatter than a flitter, whatever a flitter is. They weren't doing it. They didn't do it the right way. Thank the Lord. Hopefully I've learned a little bit of patience with people. But I'll tell you this. I don't want to fall in love with doing stuff the wrong way just because it's easier. Just because I can do it that way without praying. Just because I can do it that way and my flesh makes me feel good about it. But oh, how much greater is it when I get it right and everything is clicking and the rhythm is right and the singers are not singing behind the rhythm and they're not singing in front of the rhythm and they're on pitch. There's nobody flattening. There's nobody sharpening. You know where that comes from? That comes from not practicing. Well, it's quiet in here. What do you want to do? I want to practice. Somebody said practice makes perfect. No, practice does not make perfect. Right practice, perfect practice makes perfect. You practice it the right way. I can help almost anybody that has pitch problems. There's very, very few people in the world that are tone deaf. Very, very few people in the world that are tone deaf. And there's very, very few people in the world that have perfect pitch. Most of us have to work to get on pitch. But I'm telling you, if I work one-on-one with a person, I can bring them to pitch, and they have what is known as muscle memory in their mind. And if I work with them enough, they will sing that song on pitch because their mind, their ear will hear it, and their mind will, I don't know what it does. It just creates a place for it in their mind. Please don't turn me off. I'm fixing to close. But I'm telling you, I'm at the most important part of this message right here. I don't want to learn how to do things the wrong way just because they're easier. And I know thousands, millions of people that say they're living for God, but they're not living God's way. They're living for God their way. They're telling God, no, God, here, this is my suggestions, and if you want me to come to your church, then this is how, these are the conditions that I'm coming to your church. Well, I'm going to tell you something. You don't make deals with God. If you may come to a church, and you may have church your way, but if you want the presence of God to show up, if you want the victory of God to show up, if you want the power of the Holy Ghost to pulsate in that place where you say, oh, my God, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, then let's learn to do it the right way. we do it God's way, he says, when we do it his way, he said, then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted. Let's stand. You know, I want to have church the right way. How many of you want to have church the right way? Praise God. Doing what God thinks is right and what God gives us power to do as right is the way of God. And I'm just dealing with the dimension of righteousness now, which is very powerful. Because when we speak of righteousness, we normally think of moral codes and dress codes, and all of that's important. We do that as identity to God. But excellence is the right way because our God is excellence. Praise God. And Psalms 51 and verse number 13 says, then will I teach transgressors thy ways. Thy ways. Psalms 119 and 30 says, I have chosen the way of truth. I chose the way of truth. Now, you may have family members that don't choose the way of truth. You say, well, Brother Elder, what am I going to do? Well, what are you going to do? I know what I'm going to do. I chose the way of truth. I want those family members to come. But if they don't come, I chose the way of truth. I love them. I'll pray for them. But I'm going to tell you something. I am not going to hell for my kids. I love them. I will pray, I will fast, I will plead, I will beg, I will preach, I will do whatever I can to save my children. But I'm not going to hell for my kids. If my kids choose the way of unrighteousness, that's between them and God and the end. Because the end will come to every way that is walked. The Bible says there is a way that seemeth right to man, but that way is the way of death. I don't want to walk that way. Praise God. And so I have chosen the way of truth. Psalms 119 and 32. I will run the way of thy commandments. I'm not only going the way, I'm going to run in thy commandments. I'm not sitting there scratching my head saying, I'm wondering if I need to do this or not. No, if God says do it, then I'm ready to do it. Okay, God, all right, give me the strength to do it. Give me the strength to run in thy commandments. Give me that angel food cake that you gave Elijah when you gave that to Elijah, he was able to run for 40 days. Proverbs 2 and 8, he keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of his saints. Proverbs 4, 11, I have taught thee the way of wisdom. I have led thee in right paths. Proverbs 6, 23, for the commandment is a lamp and the law is a light, and reproofs and instructions are the way of life. Instructions are God's way. Quit resisting instruction. Quit rebelling against instruction. I don't have to do that. You know, I don't have to tell you this. We've learned this 1,000 times. That's the spirit of this city. Bless God, ain't no man going to tell me what to do. It's quite obvious. It's quite obvious by the life that you have. It's so discombobulated. It's so full of... It has potential. But the potential is never realized because you can't receive instruction. And instruction, the Bible says, is the way of life. Isaiah 35 and 8, and a highway shall be there and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring man, the fools shall not err therein. What that means is that not just... people don't just happenstance stumble up on the way of holiness. They learn the way of holiness because they want to know the way of holiness. They choose to walk that way. Praise God. Isaiah 59 and 8, the way of peace they know not, and there is no judgment in their tongue. They have made them crooked paths. Whoso goeth therein shall not know peace. When you go on paths that are crooked, when you learn the ways of men, the Bible tells you right here, there's no ways. The reason why some of you don't have peace in your life, you don't have contentment in your life, is because you're walking the wrong way. Come back over here. That's what repentance is. Repentance is correction. Repentance is correcting. Anybody that's ever flied an air, anybody that's ever flew an airplane, what grammar, understands that there's constant correction while you're flying that airplane. And if you don't have an autopilot, you can feel it in your hands. It's not a major correction, but it's constantly correcting. If you're driving a car, there's constant correction. That's called repentance, that's staying on the right course. And sometimes real repentance is an about face. You are walking this way, but bless God, now I'm walking this way. How many of you want a spirit of repentance in your life? I want the peace of God, and the peace of God can only come to me when I know the judgment of God and I walk in His ways. Amos 2 and 7 says, that pant after the dust of the earth on the head of the poor, and turn aside the way of the meek. And a man and his father will go unto the same maid to profane my holy name. God's way, according to this scripture, is the way of the meek that will humble themselves before God. The Bible says this: humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you. Quit trying to exalt yourself. Just let God do it. In His time, He will do it. If you'll do it God's way, I promise you, He will exalt you. And the final combination of God showing us His ways is through Christ. Matthew 3 and 3, for this is He that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make His paths straight. How did Christ do that? Through the Holy Ghost. And if you're here tonight and you have the Holy Ghost, be probably an important thing before you leave to just kind of plug that Holy Spirit of God in and say, okay, God, I'm just checking with you. I want to make sure I'm not walking in my own way. I want to make sure, God, that I'm walking in Your ways. I want to make sure, God, that Satan does not have influence and he's influencing me to turn away from Your ways. Would there be any here tonight that just for a few minutes, I know I've went almost 1 hour. But we have a few minutes if you want to come. Just talk to the Lord. On a Tuesday night, some of you got here late, so you weren't here for early service prayer. So why don't you just take a few minutes before you leave?
Face, you'll draw near to us.
soul longs for you. God, I worship you. Jesus, we praise you. Will you pray with me? These are your children, God. We come here tonight, God, because we're devoted to you. I pray, God, that fresh anointing would fall on your children right now. Fresh power, fresh victory, oh God. Your presence would flow with us out of this place into our cars, oh God. As we drive home, Lord Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Come on, let's pray together as a body. In the name of Jesus, let healing flow in this body as we pray right now, God. Hallelujah. That's it. Let's pray together. Let healing flow as we pray right now. Let strength flow as we pray together right now, oh God. Teach us your ways, God. Teach us the ways of holiness. Teach us the ways of righteousness. Teach us the conversation of victory, oh God. Let your anointing flow in our lives right now, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Now can you just raise your hands and let's just spend a little bit of time worship right now. Come on. Come on. We can do this for more than 5 seconds. We can do this for more than 20 seconds. We wait on you, Lord. Oh, we wait on you, Jesus. Woo! Praise God, praise God, praise God. The walk of victory is a campaign. It's not just one battle. Hallelujah. How many of you determined that I'm going to campaign until I have victory? Can you clap your hands to the Lord Jesus Christ tonight? Youth service Friday night. God's going to move in this place. Some of you people that think you're too old to come to youth service, do you know that our youth group around here is officially from 1 to 99. So we invite you to come and be a part of this. Some of the most special times with God are at our youth services on Friday night. So we invite you to come. Be with us. God's moving in a powerful way. Again, remember, the season's about Him. Don't get tied down with all of these feelings that are floating around. The Bible says, if a man warreth, he cannot entangleth himself with the things of this world. So let's remain committed to being who God called us to be and to know His ways. Amen? God bless you. Love one another. You're dismissed. Happy birthday, dear Caden. Happy birthday to you.